but I must say that sitting at lunch this afternoon.
No, is it on?
Yes, it's on.
Okay. At lunch, I was thinking that the commonality that I recognised was that actually everybody seemed to be talking about their view of ownership of this material, either as a collector, or a dealer, or a curator, or whatever, from their own personal point of view. Everybody was assuming that role in what they said, which kind of makes my point, although I don't know where that takes us. You know, what I think we're all thinking we're talking about is our human commonwealth, and yet we are all putting ourselves in the position of being the custodian or the owner of that material, nevertheless, and speaking about the subject as though we've got some kind of prior role in doing that.
Anybody else, any comments?
Not terribly common. So, as some of you may know, I have a connection with China, and I'd just like to make a couple of comments there. And my first one really is a year ago today, I was in China, and I was having lunch with a colleague, a friend of mine, who is involved in the fossil business. And it was explained to me that in the 2 years, I go to China every 2 years, so I've been there 2 years previously, and we've had lunch. And during that time, while I've been happily teaching and researching in the UK, this guy had been in prison 2 years in China, which, as those of you who've been in prison in China will know, is a great experience. I was a bit shocked, and it turned out he'd fallen foul of the law in China. He was never actually prosecuted. He was detained and held in prison for 2 years, and then just let go at the end and told to go away, basically. Which gives you some idea of the arbitrariness of how things can happen. The point I really want to make here is, you may recall that 10 years ago, it was very hard to pick up a copy of Nature or Science without seeing a paper on a fossil from China, be it a dinosaur, a pterosaur, or a bird, or whatever it might be. How many of you have seen recently? Not many. That is a direct impact of legislation that was brought in 2 or 3 years ago, which has, from my perspective, and I don't know, I'd invite my colleagues here to comment on this as well, has really slowed down the rate at which fossil material is going into the museums. And I mean the state collections in China in this respect. I mean, we could talk about their status for a long time, but I'm not going to. So we see the direct impact of what happens when you bring in legislation which, on the one hand, leads to some individuals having a lot of downtime. And I asked this guy, I said, well, 2 years in Chinese prison, what did you do? And he said, I read the entire 2 years. It was really helpful. I called upon a lot of my reading, and I thought, good for you, mate. Not the way you really want to go about it, though. But the impact on us collectively, I think, of these kinds of legislation is ultimately quite high, but also negative. And I would suggest that probably the people who drafted this were rather hoping it would have a positive impact on the situation, but clearly it didn't. So I think I'm just echoing what many other people have said with a very specific example, which is that no matter how much positive positivism we bring to these, trying to construct rules and laws and regulations to dealing with fossils, we can have some very negative impacts on what actually goes on. So I think we need to think about this in a lot more detail, and critically, it does need to involve us. I think we can all agree that a lot of the legislation, perhaps most of it, which has come through in the last decade, has not involved us by and large. So hands up anybody here who's been directly involved in the drafting of legislation with regard to fossils in their country. Ollie will now comment.
We have been asked once, actually, to have drafted a law for Bavaria, The problem basically was, well, we actually had like two goals in that. The problem was in the first round that the wrong party brought it into the parliament, and simply because it came from the wrong party, it was voted down, even though it had been drafted together with the authorities of the state. In the second round, it was a very funny thing. Haarlem, I think you were there as well when we talked about that. We had a meeting with several representatives of the state institutions, with several representatives of the commercial dealers, with quarry owners and whatever, to talk about like possible legislation, kind of informal meeting. And it's kind of interesting because basically after 10-20 minutes we were all agreeing on what would be good legislation. And then there was the leader of the Parliament Committee for Research and Education in Bavaria. And basically, after we had finished, he just said, yeah, that's all nice and fine, but it shouldn't cost anything. So, like, the state's not going to spend any money on that. So, basically, with that, obviously, any meaningful law would be impossible. And so I think that is, even if you are involved in the drafting of these things, the problem is, in the end, the decision is always with other people, and they usually have different priorities in that.
I'd say I'm a pragmatist in terms of how much you need in terms of legislation or rules or laws. One of the things I found very interesting, I know Ollie's done work in South Africa and various other people in here too, but South Africa has some very restrictive laws on owning fossils. You're not allowed to own South African fossils. It's just illegal. They are the property of the state. You're not allowed to have a private collection in South Africa. And as a result, it actually means there are large sections of South African society who are totally disengaged from the kind of work we do. Totally disengaged to the extent where we all think that dinosaurs are ubiquitous cultural icons. You go to some of the places that we work in South Africa, you meet villages of people, they've never seen a dinosaur. They don't know that you're there to dig up dinosaurs, they think that you're there to dig up diamonds or gold or steal the bones of their ancestors, because they have no other frame of reference. And part of the issue for that is that the law there has gone the other way of being too restrictive. They've done it to try and protect their cultural patrimony and to stop things leaving the country that South African scientists can work on, so that they know what that is, a laudable aim. But it's been done in such a way that it's so restrictive, and a large number of their own citizens don't get that hands-on engagement with the actual material, because it's gone too far. So rather than being allowed to have a small fossil collection that make drives enthusiasts, they don't have any of that, and they constantly struggle to recruit new undergraduates, new graduate students in paleontology and evolutionary biology, because they don't get people who engage when they're kids. They only first meet this material when they're already at university. And the number of people in places like South Africa that go to university is minuscule. And that's a problem for getting our science out. So it's another way in which these laws, even if they're under the best of intentions, unless there is some real thought about what goes into them first, they can make the situation a lot worse for everybody.
Yeah, Raymond, you were talking about that earlier in terms of the sauropod going into that it's a shopping mall, is that right?
Yes, right, it was a shopping mall in Dubai. And at first I was a little bit critical about that. When they offered me a lot of money and I had to finance a lot of other things, so I had no problem with that. But if you see these thousands of people who would never go in a public museum, being really sparked by that, standing there with their phones, making 100 photos, asking lots of questions in the mall, actually, you know, what the museum should do, but it has not the resources for it. I have like 10 people standing there explaining all the story about the dinosaur, how it was found, and so on. And I think it's a fantastic thing to bring interest to our field of science. And we have the problem that we are underestimated. I mean, art has so much money, you know, archaeology has relatively much money and has a lot of influence actually in the legislation process. So we are kind of underestimated, and that's because we don't reach out to the public as we, I think, could do or should do. And that's part of the problem. It's the same thing, you know, with the law in Germany. When they asked us, or when we were asked about that law, the law was, you know, like drafted about a year ago, and the discussion with archaeologists and with art dealers and art museums had gone on for like 9 months or 10 months already, until we were notified about the fact that this law also is affects, you know, fossils in paleontology. So I think, you know, our stand in the public is really weak, and that's something we have to change if we want to have any influence on the future legislations.
Thanks, Adam. Just to talk about this law, to give you an idea how ignorant these people are who draft these kind of laws. Actually, the first draft, and I think they changed that slightly in the end, but basically the first draft, the law was drafted basically for cultural artifacts, for archaeological artifacts, and for arts.
The national law?
Yeah, the national law in Germany. And the Contributions Gazette that was just passed down. And the funny thing is, like, basically we just like fell under it by default because they didn't have any other category for us to go into. And in the first draft of the law, basically, they included simply in the list of things that this law applied to, all other items of paleontological or scientific importance or value. And so basically, this law, in this first draft, it would declare everything in a public collection that is of paleontological or scientific value as a cultural heritage of the state of Germany, of the nation of Germany. And as such, every move of location would need a permit. Every alteration of the material would need a permit. So if you want to prepare a specimen, you need a state permit. If you want to sample a specimen, do histology or whatever, you would need a permit. If you want to give a loan, you would need a permit. And so obviously these people had no idea what they were doing there. The thing is, as I think Dino has referred to that earlier, the problem there was also that, like, basically the politician who had drafted that, the guy who actually had wrote the law, was a lawyer, not even an artist or whoever from the museum business. He basically refused to listen to any arguments or whatever, so they didn't really want to change any of that anymore. And I think that is a problem. And I think education here is a key factor, as Raymond said as well. And I think in that respect, there's again something that obviously we can do as the scientific community, and one thing is obviously try to get your results out in the popular literature, like do press releases and all these kind of things so that people are aware of it. I think we're pretty good at that. I mean, I read more about paleo in newspapers and whatever than about most other fields of science. But the other thing I think, I would be interested in how that is in other countries. One of the problems, for example, for us in Germany is paleontology doesn't play any role in school education. The example of Archaeopteryx might come up at some stage, but that's basically about it. There's no other reference to paleo. And I think there's something that we might be able to do to try to get more paleo into the school curricula, or also try to go directly into the schools and offer, I don't know, workshops, whatever, with the kids, because I mean the school kids are usually interested in the subject. It's not that they don't want to. It's basically, it's just missing in the school curriculum.
Is that a religious problem?
No, I don't think so. It's just that the people who draft these things also don't really care about that. It's like the laws and the rules and whatever are made by people who don't care about the paleo. In a lot of It's let's say, in that respect, it's a general problem even with evolutionary biology. You know that evolution obviously is like plate tectonics for geology. It's the theory in biology that explains basically everything. And even that, I think, in Germany, first time that the school kids hear about evolution is something in ninth grade. And then it's just like a very casual glancing over. And so I think these are all really important things.
You don't have to teach evolution. You can teach paleontology without even saying the E word.
Right. problem with the schools is, at least in Germany, is that the teachers don't understand our subject. The teachers in our schools are not really educated in paleontology at all. The kids are crazy about dinosaurs, they are crazy about paleontology. You know, we are opening one of these dinosaur theme parks, and we have a huge list of schools applying. Because what we offered is, we said, okay, the teacher can stand outside, have coffee, and we will explain paleontology to kids. And that's so successful, and I think the problem is the teachers just don't understand. And we have to teach the teachers first to get access to the kids. And if we reach that broad public, we have less problems with raising funds to, you know, get the buses we need for the new schools.
Okay, one point.
So maybe at first, as an excuse, I'm a teacher's daughter in Germany. So and in Germany, we have something like earth sciences in school, and that's geography and maybe geology or paleontology. And that always depends on what the teacher has learned at university. And usually that's geography, and then you get, I don't know, maps of minerals or something, of like the most interesting minerals which are like in a productive way important. And I think the problem is that like engineering science, for example, is not part of the curriculum in a narrow sense. So I usually see that kids are always totally into dinosaurs and fossils, and they have absolutely no problem with identifying with it and finding it interesting. But the problem is, adults usually say, what do you want to do with paleontology? Can you make money with that? And somewhere in between, obviously the interest drops, and maybe that's going too far, but I think that also derives from like the 70s or the 60s, the late 60s, especially in Germany, where natural sciences were not really the thing to do. Like, you had to study philosophy, sociology, and it was all the humane sciences, the humanities, yeah, and there was a general dislike into natural sciences, and I think we still have the problem to get young people to study natural sciences, actually. And I think, I don't know if it's just a German thing, but I feel that generally people think that studying natural sciences is a problem, that's still not well reputed.
So the message being, the only way you get good lawmakers is by getting them in the primary schools when they're young.
Well, I think we're discussing something that's very powerful and very important, that's science outreach. And I don't see how restrictive or, if you will, protective laws have anything to do with science outreach. It's actually just postponing the responsibility to other people. We all have the responsibility of doing science outreach. We have to go to schools, we have to try to do museums or build new museums or get new fossils into museums, not just study, publish them, and then put them in a drawer for the next paleontology, and never getting this kind of information for the general public. Also, we can be more active, not just in science outreach to the general public, to schools or whatever, politicians. We do have to go after politicians. They're not going to come after us and ask for our opinion on us. They're not going to do this. Most politicians are not even interested in paleontology. They have no idea what a fossil is. They think of fossils or dinosaur bones or something like this. We have to go after politicians. So you elect someone, you have their email, and you have to write them or you have to call them. If we just stay, they're never going to ask us. It's not going to happen. These guys, they don't have any knowledge of paleontology. Sometimes our own colleagues at the university who work with, recent animals or recent plants, they don't have this understanding as paleontology, as a science that just keeps everything together, that explains evolution, that explains how animals or plants are distributed today. They have a hard time understanding what we do, at least they have a hard time understanding what I do for sure. So we can't just, you know, sit back and wait for them to come after us. We have to do something. If we don't have this kind of active attitude, nothing's going to change. And we have to talk about more public outreach then. Let's do this. Let's talk about people. Let's go to schools. Let's do something. If we just stay in a museum, we're going just to attract a very small public. Sometimes people who live in the cities where museums are, sometimes no tourists who go to the larger cities where the museums are. What about the small communities? How do we approach them? If we don't do anything active in this sense, nothing's going to change. We have lots of new generations of politicians who don't know anything about paleontology, how things work.
Combating ignorance is a popular topic since the Enlightenment.
I guess what you said is really correct. If we are not active enough, we will simply be steamrolled down by politicians that ignore us. But still, there are some ways we have to propose something. Where do we want to go as a society? We are a European society, and the German law is an adaptation to European law. This is a clear evidence. And this law exists in England since a long time and in other countries as well. So if we do not agree with that law, we should criticize that on a European level. This is my opinion to that. And I did not hear your lecture from the very beginning. The fossil protection law that existed in Baden-Württemberg was not an obligation for fossil sites in the case of Solnhofen. It was invoked by city scientists of museum, and they wanted to have it ages ago as this, but there was no need because you can talk to it's open to us. We do have an excellent site, but we don't have a fossil protection site where we work. So we have an agreement with the city, and we want to improve the knowledge about this site in the city, and we want that they build a museum for themselves and show the regional treasures. And there is no law necessary for that. If you want to dig, come. Just come. But it's dirty. And it's just too young for you, it's Oligocene. But this possibility exists, and this law is ruined with the new national law concerning schools. I'm married to a teacher. And she is a member of the curriculum committee. And we both discussed that curriculum committee, and in Germany it is a matter of fact that the industries have a direct influence on the education in natural sciences. The first problem is they want to lump all the subjects together. There is no biology before class 3 in the gymnasium, and they want to exterminate that completely, and we forced it to be back. Yeah, now it's called biology and natural phenomena. Natural phenomena! Do you understand what a natural phenomenon is? This is what our pupils have to learn. What is a natural aura? It's a natural phenomenon of moving things. Yeah? But this is so imprecise, and everything has to be equal. This is the reason why they lump every natural history subject into one single subject. So the biology remained, and immediately came the protest from the industry. Why do you leave the word biology in there? We don't want to see that. So this is not science what we're talking about. This is a politics that is permanently and constantly declining education in Europe, especially in Germany for the moment. And this decline we feel when we get the students out of the university. They are results of funny ideas like the G8. Make your abitur in 8 years instead of 9. So rush them through that they get productive, but please do not learn biology, geology, or geography properly. This is one of our key problems we have to face.
And this is where we have to put the lever, and we had a chance, and this should show that it works first. So transmit science is something that could help there. Yeah? Transmit science has that attitude, and we have something similar, especially us in the Natural History Museum in Karlsruhe. It's called Science into Schools. It's financed by the same state to demolish education at school. And we educate multiplicators, teachers, since 2009, every year financed by the state of Baden-Württemberg. And this is simply because we did what Terrasa said. Exactly that. We approached multiplicators, we tried to twist the arms of responsible politicians, and bang, we were in. And now we try to maintain that, and I can only encourage everybody to do so and to try the best in that way. But we also, as an association, should come up with a referendum on what we want concerning fossil trade and fossil excavation and scientific excavations, and hang that out to our homepage and send it to the responsibles in the European community. And there we want to have an idea, and I propose, Jeff, that we collect these ideas and present some kind of a referendum next year, that we do something and not just sit around and complain. Or do you disagree, Christian?
Yeah, my people like referendum. Sorry, there's another German speaking to you, albeit with a more American accent. So, just real quick on the way it's done, I think in all European countries, maybe, I don't know about the UK, when I'm talking to, at my university, I simply talk to the people who educate the secondary school teachers. And I just struck up this cooperation. So those of you at universities, try to find out, you have teacher education, biology, talk to them, and they say, yes, we get dinosaurs into the curriculum. That's what we're doing. And there are all these journals for teachers, write dinosaur articles for them. Okay, but that's not what I really want to talk about. What I did want to talk about is what I thought was really a cool symposium, but I was missing a few things, and that is a cold, hard look at the money side. To get any further, we need to have some serious economic expertise, and really, and if your policy or people, policymakers said, hey, can't cost us any more money, then you have to say, no, it does cost us money, no matter what. And so then we have to talk about what's the most cost-efficient way of getting data for our science. And this is a legitimate thing, and we may find out that Riemann's dinosaur is more value for money than if I dig it up with a public service salary. So just, and I think to move further, maybe it would be good really to get like really economic counseling or somebody, and also lawyers and really ethics experts. So the one thing I really took home here in terms of ethics is that we have a clear ethical conflict. And one is maximize scientific data, which means dig up as many fossils as possible. On the one hand, on the other hand, reproducibility. And those are both very highly valuable ethical goals, and I don't see a solution yet. So I think, I don't know if SVP, Paul, are they getting any further with this conflict? But it's a clear conflict right there. And of course, this is typical for ethics, that you run into these conflicts. But you have to, nobody here said, we have a clear conflict here, which is what I see. And nobody really said, what's the flow of money? This gets me back to open access. And that's how I explain to my students what open access is all about. I just said, just look at the flow of money. Look at the interests, and then you get for an understanding of the system.
Yeah, follow the money.
Sure.
So those of you who don't know, I'm on the SVP Executive Committee, so I'm one of the people that helps develop SVP policy on a variety of different things. And we have been looking again at our ethics position recently, actually more to do with issues of social equality and so on than to do actually with professional ethics. So we spent a lot of time in the last 2 years redrafting some of those things. And the ethics statement is one that is currently being looked at again, although it's not been very well developed so far. It's got about probably another few months to go on it, among other things. But one of the things that a number of our colleagues in the US, which are represented here really today, in the way that, in terms of an extreme view, is we have a number of colleagues in the US, for example, who in any discussion of private ownership or private dealing is complete anathema. Right? Really, really, Dave Martin and I were talking about this in the break. They are ideologically against the buying or selling of fossils under any circumstances, and actually have the philosophical position they would rather not see one of those fossils ever come to light, rather than it be in a private collection. So for another extreme view of what they were doing, that was a voice that was missing in the room. And SDP is trying to balance the views of people like that, who make up a significant proportion of the professional membership of SDP in North America, versus people like me who are kind of sort of in the middle, that just want things to work. And then there are other people who have a more laissez-faire attitude. Maybe Dave represents the other far end extreme of that, way of putting that position today. So they're having real trouble coming up with a way that actually balances the needs of the commercial subject, because there are ethical issues there, as Dave said, to do with people's livelihoods. There are ethical issues to do with reproducibility, access to information, increasing information, and it might be that the wise heads of the SVP exec committee are simply not up to the task of finding the suitable compromise on that. So if we could do that, I'll be running for head of the United Nations.
Right, thanks for bringing us up to date on this. There's one twist to the matter. It's another aspect that I've been missing, and that is, of course, especially from that section of the hardliner, so to speak, among the American colleagues, that is particularly striking, because in the Anglo-Saxon law, you have this great distinction between access to land that's private versus that's public, something that is not known in continental Europe, especially north of the Alps. And so to have these hardliners in a country where there is basically any fossil or paleontological patrimony that is on private land is unprotected and unprotectable, probably, is particularly striking. And I just wonder, I mean, for me, Sue and some other cases where really drove home this point that, especially in America, the legal situation is just extremely complicated. And just really this distinction between private and public land and property, something that we've not touched on, except, I mean, it's just, Kirby could tell you a lot more about this. So.
I mean, to be fair, this is actually one of the reasons why this meeting happened at EABP. I do some work on the Government Affairs Committee of SVP, and I was surprised at the fears of holding such a meeting as this in terms of actually having anybody commercial involved at all. There was a real sense, actually, no, we can't do that. We don't want to let them in the room, it's going to be like a plague. And the funniest thing was that the most concession that I could get from them was that, oh, wait, SVP, we're going to be out in North America, we're going to be in Europe soon. Yeah, we can have a workshop then, when it's out of North America, then it's safe to do it. It's like, what? So I'm glad that that you have been able to do this even in a small way today.
One of the things as a North American collector I wanted to address, and it goes back to a couple of things that were talked about today. First, we've had people from actually Canadians go on television that are living in the United States now, trying to convince people that the United States government, federal government, should use eminent domain to seize the private property of individuals when certain scientists decide that there are important specimens on their own property. That does not go over very well, especially in the western part of the United States. So that gentleman from Kenosha is not very popular, but the statement that was made about the scientists that would rather see things go to gravel than for a private collector to collect them on public land or even on private land in some cases, he was very he was adamant about that, even to some of the ranchers up in Montana that say this or that own this property. But these ranchers in Montana are also finding specimens on government land, or know about the laws that are supposed to be there to protect the specimens, do their due diligence, report them to the BLM or whatever government entity that's supposed to be protecting them, and then the BLM does nothing. And you've touched on that before too, they're on the other side of the fence. We have theropods, we have ceratopsians that we've known of for 12 years now, since we started working in the Judith River Formation, that we've reported them to people that have permits in the area, to the BLM office, to the regional offices there, and nothing has been done. And the ranchers up there, the private property owners, are wondering why they should respect any of these laws if nothing's going to be done with them whatsoever. And that can be applied for a lot of places all across the world. So right now, in two weeks, I'm headed up to Montana to meet up with the Denver Museum to go and finally look at some of these sites that have been languishing for over a decade in some cases, waiting for somebody to come up and work on these specimens. So, and they're not doing it. And nobody wants to lift a finger. And when the Denver Museum applied for a permit, the current permit holder basically contacted me and said, well, I have the permits in that area. You can't do it. I'm not going to work on the specimens, but you can't do it. And it's not their place to do it. And so it's really screwed up out in the West, too, sometimes. So, and this is what we have to deal with being commercial collectors, is that the people out there that do have specimens on private property that are collectible by commercial collectors or by government entities are worried then that if we found, as a private collector, an interesting specimen, I know of an ankylosaur on one of these properties up in the Judith River Formation, supposedly pretty well preserved, articulated, beautiful thing. The guy will not let anybody look at it because he's terrified that the government will come and seize his livelihood just for having this on his property, just by dumb luck. So
one of the reasons why I'm just so against any law being brought in to protect fossils is because I see so many anomalies that seem to get in the way. At the risk of saying some stories that are perhaps apocryphal, I'll give you three examples. One of them is knowledge generally. One of the PhD students in my university is working on the Burgess Shale in Canada, and it took an awful long time to get permits to go and sample the Burgess Shale. And her project involves looking at some trace fossils, some burrows in there, and her permits allow her only to collect trace fossils and no other fossils. And this involved a week camping at the site, all of the logistics that go into doing that, and all of the other fossils were just simply not to be collected and discarded. She was only allowed to bring down from the mountain the trace fossils, and the other fossils were simply discarded. It wasn't even a question of put them on the site and somebody else would come and get them, just discarded. And a ranger came up to make sure that they weren't collecting any other fossils but the trace fossils. So that's one story, that's not apocryphal, that's absolutely the case. Now another one which I'm not so sure of, is anybody from Spain here? Okay, so maybe you can tell me if I'm wrong here, but I've been working in Spain for a long time. We used to teach undergraduate mapping just north of Madrid. We used to go to some Cretaceous localities, and we were made aware that it's illegal to collect fossils in Spain, and so we never collected any fossils. But maybe on occasion the students perhaps weren't so strict about it, and would pick up some little ephemera and things like that. Fairly frequently, going through Madrid airport, these things might show up as you go through the X-ray, and we have them taken from us. Just little bags of little echinoids which were lying around. So they've recovered these fossils, they're no good to anybody. They're quite a thrill for the students to collect. But the law was just simply applied. Paolo Brito was trying to work on some fishes, not fossil fishes, but living fishes, and he pointed out that the law that was protecting fossils also covered sampling natural objects for scientific analysis. And he found that he struggled to get a permit to be able to get some fish that you could kill to examine their anatomy. But a fisherman could just simply go and get a rod license and go and collect his fish and eat them. So the scientist was absolutely struggling to get the paperwork to be able to get a fish to look at its anatomy. But anybody can just go and catch one and eat it. And that struck me as really rather bizarre. And another one, is there anybody from Italy here? Because this is another country. So again, maybe you can tell me.
I'm from Spain.
You're from Italy and Spain?
Spain.
Yeah, the thing with Spain is actually we have a general legislation, and each province
have their own legislation. So actually, it depends where you're going. So it's not the same in Catalonia than in Madrid, than in the south of Spain, in Valencia. Some places you can collect, no problem. And some years ago, well, we have a lot of people from Zaragoza here. I was working there, and it was like crazy. I mean, you don't go to the thing with a hammer, because you can be put into jail. So I think that was, you know, better than I, that was crazy. And the other point, coming back to the issue that Lino pointed out, after we did, we already go to the schools and talk about fossils and try to link it to evolution, but then we cannot bring the kids to the field. That is the thing that they want to do. It will be much easier to bring the field, and we cannot. So actually, the legislation is quite tight. Weird. I think that we cannot do it.
And we have an Italian. I think Massimo da Fino.
I'll just tell my Italian story, and again, it may be apocryphal, but I've been told a similar story by several. It's, again, as far as I understand, it's illegal to collect fossils without some sort of license. There's a bureaucracy that makes it difficult to get that license. But a story that I was told was that somewhere in the south, there was a locality where lots of people would casually go and collect animals, but there was an enthusiast for protecting the fossils, who would, every time he saw people in the quarry, he would report it to the police. So the police would then come up to the quarry, and then they would, I don't know that they arrested people that told them that they couldn't do it, but the police got so fed up that they went to the quarry with hammers and smashed all the fossils. it may or may not be true, but I throw it out there anyway. But what concerns me is that legislation is brought in without any thought as to the effects of that legislation, knee-jerk legislation. And let me also say that politicians can, if you like, get a lot of brownie points by bringing in laws that protect things. It sounds good, doesn't it? I'm your local MP, and I was the one who brought in the law to protect your geological and paleontological heritage. Aren't I good? And he only lost 3 votes, yeah? Because we're not, well, the world isn't full of paleontologists with voting power. But if he brought in some other legislation which was banning diesel cars from city centres, nobody with a Land Rover Defender would ever vote for him. Or any other car running a diesel engine, you see. So they get, if you like, legislation to get easy kudos without losing any votes. And I kind of feel that we suffer in the end. We end up having to fill in forms, we end up chasing bureaucracy, and now you tell me that it's not just one state, but you've got to find out what the law is in that particular province in Spain, or what have you. I don't think anybody should go to prison for finding fossils. And it just sounds to me bloody awful. The things are already dead.
Yeah, but you would say that, wouldn't you? Kirby, did you want to say something?
Okay. What I wanted to make clear that from my experience that I've had, it's the best fossils are still out there. And what do we do as a group here to go out and collect these important fossils? I'm not speaking about the common ammonites or coral or about vertebrate fossils. And I often wondered, what kind of a percentage do we now, as a human race, are we collecting now of important fossils? Yeah, what, how much do you think? Do we collect 50%? More or less? No. I think we collect not even 10% of what could be collected, what might be very important pieces. They're still out there someplace, and nobody collects them. And they go to pieces before anybody ever appreciates the fossil. And I think our biggest concern as a group in here should be, how do we collect these fossils? And anyway, of, you know, how we manage to get through the jungle of regulations and rules that we can collect these fossils. That's our most important task. And so, but I would like to encourage young people here not to give up when things look difficult, go and fight for it, you know? Go and do it, because it's a wonderful thing, and it needs time, it needs patience, it needs sweat and tears maybe, but the greatest things are still out there.
I'm going to make a really deep philosophical point here. Don't worry. This time last year, I sat on a hill, northern China, looked at the Yixian Formation, which is a Cretaceous, produces all those amazing dinosaurs and feathered theropods and that kind of nonsense, and I could see it going over there, and then I could see it going over there, and then it was right over there, and I thought, there are thousands or millions of dinosaurs and pterosaurs and fish in this particular unit, and I wonder how many other rock units are actually like this. And here's a little thought experiment. We talk about losing fossils because of erosion. How long has that landscape in China been eroding like that? Half an hour? 10,000 years? 100,000 years? Longer? So the point I want to make is, we are worried about our time right now. This is something that Dave and I have talked about quite a bit. If we look at this with a much longer viewpoint, we can actually be quite philosophical. We will get those fossils. We will reconstruct the history of life, but we might not do it right now. But we will in the future. So when you go away perhaps feeling slightly depressed at the thought of what politicians do and what legislation does, I would say, yeah, but it all goes away eventually, and we will get our fossils. I hope that wasn't too philosophical.
Not for somebody from museum studies, no. Erin, are you wanting to?
Just a quick comment on the legislation controlling the Virgil Shale site. The reason it's so difficult to work in the Virgil Shale specifically is because it's located in a national park. So it's not the provincial legislation or the national legislation that is the problem. It is the Park Service, and that has its own specific set of rules. The province actually is a province without specific fossil protection legislation. And there are Virgil Shale Age sites elsewhere in the Cordillera that are accessible without permits.
I said that, I know of one example in Scotland, the Southern Fish Locality, where we were collecting out there for two museums as a collaborative thing with SNH, Scottish National Heritage, and we had one of their officers was there with us for the day, and at the end of the day, after they sorted out what specimens were to which one, he insisted that the rest of the specimens were smashed, so that nobody could accidentally find them afterwards, and actually know that there was a fossil locality there. So I trunk your British history.
So there's been quite a lot of complaining about legislation and stuff, but you know, legislation exists, right? So we just have to deal with it. So I think Kirby's point is a really good one, so how do we move forward within the framework of the legislation that exists? And with regards to that, I'm kind of interested to know, like, the people on the panel, like Ollie and Paul, and maybe you guys can comment on this, but the in the States, for example, in Colorado, they actually have a paleontologist embedded in the Department of Transportation, for example, so that when they do a road dig, when they dig a new road, like we were talking about earlier, their paleontologist goes and checks out the site and checks to see if there's any important paleontological resources there. And likewise, in the UK, when they do similar things, they can have an archaeological watching group, so we have an archaeologist who looks in the pit. We don't have that with paleontologists. Do you think this is a way that we can, can we move forward with this? As a community, could we lobby to get paleontologists embedded in public bodies to do things like this?
There's been a lot of talk about bad and wolf laws today. And one of the interesting things is in the Detmashoots area, the Holzmaden area, when there are construction projects, large-scale construction projects, they do have, the companies do have to provide money for a spotter litigation person to go out to the site. So for instance, the Deutsche Bahn has a project now in the area, and there is money available to do resource, paleontological resource mitigation at the building site. Now, unfortunately, they're not going as deep as they thought they were, so they're not going to be in the most fossiliferous layers of the Posidonia shale, but theoretically, this is a possibility.
Okay, we're going to have to wind this up. Does anybody want to respond to Susie's point?
Two questions about this, the future that you were talking about. 20 years time from now, why do you dig them out at all? There will be technology to scan them right in there, and people can make 3D models out of them and decide then after that whether you really do need to take them out at all. So that's one point. The second point is about this great talk that you gave, and I was impressed by these fossils that came out of Peru you put into your museum in Switzerland. This is actually not very much different than the Spanish did with the silver. And what I would like to ask you, because there was obviously great controversy, particularly in the developing world, of what are you doing with our fossils? This is a kind of a scientific colonialism that's going on. I'm not saying that I agree with this, but this is one of the arguments that's going to come. How would you design something in your museum that would allow young Peruvians who can't afford to come and see your museum to actually see these fossils? And today, with modern technology and 3D printing, that wouldn't be such a far-fetched idea. But there is a responsibility for people bringing sources here to allow young people in what we might call the developing world to actually see what was there.
Kirby, then we're going to have to wind up.
And the right response to that, when you know, I got a permit from the Instituto de la Cultura in, to dig up 5 whale specimens, and that was a trade-off. I was obliged to build a museum, a local museum, on top of a whale specimen. And so maybe you missed that point. I think I had it in my lecture that before we came. The site was known as Cementerio de Dinosaurios. They thought it was dinosaurs, but they're actually whales. And so the structure that we put up does not only protect the whale, but it also explains the geology, you know, and the nature of the fossils that could be found in the area. So actually, we did contribute it in the long-term way. We also instructed, when we always took Peruvian students along with us to help them in learning field techniques, and so there's many things we delivered to the Museo de Historia Natural in Lima, a set of fossils that they could use for their own. So there was a lot of things that we did to compensate, because it was also in the beginning our belief that it should not be profitable only for us, but also for the county of origin.
Yeah, I understand that trade-off. That's a simple trade-off for our generation. But I think the younger generation in the developing world is not going to see that as a good enough trade-off. And we should be preempting it.
Okay, any final comments? Anybody want to come back with any comments, please? If not, go on, David, you get to say the last thing.
Just a very general thing that unfortunately we wouldn't need. Just to your very general point that in the future maybe we won't need to dig things up anymore. Many of these things aren't actually in the ground, on the ground, they're even building right now. So if you know, people can watch them make their own. The other thing is that although there are scanning methods and so such like getting better and better. This actually came up in one of the talks today. Chemical methods, isotope physics methods, need the real thing that cannot be done on a cast or 3D print.
It's a very, very tiny little drill hole down today to get into a bone to do your chemistry.
Yeah.
It's completely non-destructive. In situ.
Who else should end to end this symposium with Dave Martell?
I just want to say that Richard Owen broke the law to progress science, and he got a knighthood.
I have to say, I don't fancy your chances, but anyway. And on that bombshell, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your attention. There'll be a short 5-minute turnaround period while we set up for the AGM, and the auction will take place thereafter. But thank you very much for your paying attention today.